assembly politics across the car park. Privacy confidentiality. Can I remind everyone present who has any items relating to personal, private, confidential or exempt information, ensure that these items are not on display until such time that they may be required. Recordings. Can all present please be aware that proceedings of the meeting may be recorded and streamed live. If any observers have any objection to being filmed, please indicate now. Mobile phones. Can I ask that all mobile phones are switched to silent? So I'll now open the meeting. So we do have two apologies. Councillor Rennie and Councillor Angassi. Can I ask for any declarations of interest in relation to any item? No. No matters of agency that I know of? No. And there are no items of exempt business to consider on the agenda. Okay. So the minutes of the previous meeting, can I ask that they be a true record? So we'll now go on to agenda item 3, which is the Health, Safety and Welfare Annual Report 21-32. Nick is going to introduce the report, and then we're going to get a presentation by Craig.
Thanks, Chair. Yeah, there's really not much for me to say, to be honest, because it's a presentation by Craig, so it's probably better if we go straight into the presentation, and I will be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Councillors, Chair, Deputy Chief Executive, my name is Craig Whitfield. I'm the Health and Safety Manager for the organisation. And you will have in your packs the annual Health and Safety Report for period 2021-22. And I'm going to talk you through what that looks like now. Okay, so the annual report will cover how we performed in terms of health and safety, okay? And broadly that will cover workplace, which is place and people, so accident injury, and it will also look at road risks, so the management of how we manage road risk across the organisation. At the end of the report there's some additional reporting areas, so I'll talk through how we performed in terms of inspection, audit and monitoring. Firstly, I just want to start by making a statement. So this statement is embedded in our policy and procedure for health and safety, and there's a real commitment from yourselves as the authority members, from the Chief Fire Officer, strategic leadership team, that health, safety and welfare is a priority in the organisation, okay? And that's fundamentally supported by the structures we have in place through Health, Safety and Welfare Committee, and then the other subgroups that help manage that on a daily basis. So I'll start by going through workplace, which is the accident and injury. Okay, so for the 21-22 period, there was a total of 36 operational injuries to staff members. Of the 36, 27 individuals remained in work, 9 individuals booked sick, but out of the 9 that booked sick, 4 returned within 7 days. So what that tells us is that actually most of the injuries were minor in nature. Non-operational staff, there were 9 injuries with no individuals booking sick, so again, all very minor in nature. Okay, so I'll break down now and just talk through each of the ones as they are local performance indicators. So the first one's the number of operational staff injuries at incidents. Okay, so for this reporting period, we had 15 staff injuries at operational incidents. 11 of those members of staff stayed in work, 4 went off duty, but out of the 4, 3 returned within 12 days. And the individuals who remained off work, that accumulated to approximately 22 days of duty days that were lost. The next one is operational training. So for operational training, as you can see, sorry, risk critical training, there was 10 injuries, okay, which is up on the previous year. And out of them 10 injuries, 3 went off duty, 3 of the injuries occurred in the same event. But what I'd like to kind of highlight is in this, so on the previous year, we were still in kind of the grasp of COVID. So when I've done a detailed analysis of that increasing actually core training, so BA, road traffic collision training, working at heights with water training, etc., was up by 68% on the previous year. And then actually our off-station exercises, so where we were training at the Gable Green high rise at Kirby, or off-station on local risks, that was up 75%, okay? And of course, we ran through the group. So in terms of the actual exposure to this critical training environment, was massively up on the previous years. What's also highlights as well is that, you know, most the majority of those are low-level injuries. So the 3 that occurred in one event was reddening of the skin, small blisters following realistic fire behaviour training. So that's where they come out and either the gloves were a bit wet or touched on the side of the compartment and it's ended up in reddening of the skin. But the individuals treated remains on duty with no long-lasting effects on that. So the ops routine, so all the other stuff we do that's non-operational, dealing with incidents or risk critical training, there were 11, which is good to see, and that was down on previous years. 9 of those 11 remained on duty, and 2 went off duty, which resulted in 20 duty days being lost. So for non-operational staff also, again, another figure decrease. So that was down from 15 to 9 injuries across the report in the year. We do a trend analysis on all of this. So what we found was actually there wasn't really any trend for these injuries other than they were all minor in nature. So we had pain only, puncture penetration, bruising, sprain, strain, etc. And also the age ranges varying quite greatly. So we have an obligation under certain circumstances to report through the HSE for incidents that are visually reportable. Okay, so in terms of any major injuries for the 21-22 period, there were 0, which is really good. And for the minor injuries, there was 6 to report on. Out of those injuries, there were 6, 2 were sprain and strain injuries, 1 was a pain only injury that did result in absence from work. And then there was a hot burn, scald, and a foot laceration. So again, all minor in nature, and most individuals stayed in work. Okay, so nearness reporting, you'll see there was a peak of nearness reporting in 1920, and that's decreased. And when we've looked at that, we're kind of attributing that decrease to obviously COVID. So during COVID, we had less individuals in work. And it was part of the 21-22 period as we transitioned out of COVID back into normal business as usual. But also, because of the culture and the positive reporting, there was less things to report upon. However, we are now pushing to continue with hopefully increasing the nearness reporting and safety observations as we move forward. Okay, so that kind of covers off the accident injury, and again, the full detail of that is within the report within the pack. So in terms of road risk, so this is the other element that my department manages. We operate a fleet of approximately 228 vehicles and covered easily in excess of 1 million miles during the period, and that covers blue light response and routine activity. So the total number of road traffic collisions involving all types of vehicles was 62, and whilst an increase of 4 from the previous year, we still remain under the predicted target of by 10, which is approximately 14%. So again, this is broken down into certain reporting elements. A few of these are actually reported on the other deals that we out of our control and we monitor. So fire clients hitting another vehicle or object whilst responding on blue light response. So there's a real focus on this from the previous year because it had peaked a relatively high number as opposed to the years prior to that. So there's a real focus from the health and safety department using the station managers and a number of different facets that we were able to kind of progress our work and focus on this. And what we were able to do is to reduce that from 34 down to 27. So all the empirical data will say that we would be in and around 27 collisions for the important period, sorry, 28, and we managed to come in at 27. So routine activities, so that's the fire appliances, doing everything else that we do in the community. That was up on previous years, and you know, will now remain a focus of the current year that we're in. It was 27, which was what the different performance line would say would be around. So the team have been working to have a look at causal factors of that and sort of methods to be able to drive forward and reduce that further. The light vehicle response, so senior officers responding or officers with specialist skill sets, etc. As again, consecutive remains at zero, so that's been zero for many years now, which is a real positive. And then the routine activity of the light vehicles, so that's all the tender drivers, workshops, prevention staff, protection staff, etc. Again, further reduced, so that went down from, as you can see, in 2018-19-14 down to 8 last year. And again, that was another real positive to see that downward decline in those incidents. So the next two offer monitoring only. So damage while stationary, so this is coming across damage that has occurred whilst the vehicle has been stationary or during response or routine activity. And sometimes these are harder to kind of define. So, for example, if an inspection of a car is done and we found some damage, a dent, etc., then we do still investigate that, but if it's not being picked up at any other time, sometimes it's difficult to kind of establish what the causal factor is on that. However, something we will continue to monitor. And then hit by other vehicle, so this is a third party member of the public colliding with our vehicles, so slightly up on the 2021, but that came in at 14, and again, my department and myself work very closely with legal and conduct investigations, etc. So outside of the local performance indicators, which we monitor for performance and I've just gone through, the team also conducts an array of other health and safety activities. Some of the key ones are the inspections and orders of all the premise, okay? So all our stations, headquarters, workshops, training, academy, etc., all receive an annual health and safety general inspection. That's a really full-out inspection. It takes members of my team sort of half a day to a day to complete, and then they will pick up anything that needs to be taken forward with either states or any other department. And then station managers who manage stations, they also undertake general health and safety inspections on a monthly basis. So they will walk around the station, they will look at estates, they will look at accommodation, they will look at the appliances and so on and so forth. And during this report period, 96% of them were completed. 4% was linked to quite a significant absence through COVID of the station manager group and also some changes. So hopefully that will be back up to 100% for the forthcoming year. I look forward, so what's this report told us in terms of what we're moving forward with the next report, with the kind of focus for health and safety. So we're really going to try and continue to decrease the figures in accidents and injuries and in collisions. We're going to look to increase the near miss reporting because there's a correlation between accidents and injury and near miss. We're really using data quite intelligently, and we are drilling down into all the data to help us really focus in on appliance collisions, and that's more significantly around is there a trend in terms of station, location, driver, etc., etc. We'll continue with the inspections, and we'll support our representatives on the station, so our health and safety reps will work with trade union health and safety reps to undertake inspections, and then we will broaden our that collaboration to make sure we are working with Fire Brigade Union and FOA. Oceans is the health and safety management system that we use to capture everything, and we've had that for quite a long time now. But what we are finding, we're having some technical difficulties at times, so we are going to focus on the suitability and sustainability of the Oceans system, and then also collaboratively I link into the regional NFCC health and safety group, which feeds into the national group, and we're doing working quite tightly with them, looking at areas such as fire contamination, etc. So that's the kind of commitment going forward outside of the building GPs. Okay, thank you. I'm happy to take any questions.
I'm just shouting.
Yes. Just of the RTCs under blue light, is there any distinction made there between those that were avoidable and those that were actually necessary to get to an emergency on time?
So it's probably not distinctive within the report. However, we have a very structured process for investigation of all collisions. So whether it's a wing mirror or something more significant, we review all the CCTV, we look at the instant type that the crew were mobile to, and so on and so forth. What we do actually find is that 90-95% of the time they are low speed collisions, so they are moving forward, they are going through tight gaps, which in essence sometimes could be avoidable. But we do look at all that, we just don't make the distinction within kind of the report on. There isn't, but the reason they've now been broken down into quarters, previously they may not have been that detailed, to try and get some more of that raw data and then analyse that in terms of different standards. So we've got three quarters of the year, one accident, 7 accidents, but actually all them accidents coming out of winter time. Or, you know, alternatively, that's the same with collisions, driving conditions may be icy, etc. So we are continue looking at that data analysis at this present time. Hopefully, that's something that we're just kind of embarking upon in terms of quarters, seasons, time of day, etc.
Yeah, it's just that thought that the last few days have been quite terrible. The weather and quite sunshine and then absolutely cold. And it's not so much that staff here, but it's weather.
So it is recorded in the investigation, so whenever the investigation comes in, it's probably not formalised in terms of, we actually record through our data time of day, so night, morning, etc. And that gives us an indication of intake collisions, if the road's busy, is it 5 o'clock on a, you know, kind of a winter's evening, etc. But we would probably look to kind of report that down to the chair in terms of some of them factors, such as weather.
Okay, can I just say that?
Very briefly on that, to just reassure you that if we do have any adverse weather coming of any nature, the staff get notified of that. So if the emails go out to it, if we do have frost coming or snow or heavy rain, the race team will send emails out to notify people to put the necessary measures in place as well.
Thank you.
Okay,
that's
Linda. Yeah, can I ask,
and
thanks for the presentation, it was very good. Can I just ask you, because of the parking situation at the moment, I know we're an island, you can hardly get the hand in a car because it's so many cars at the moment. What would happen if a fire engine was trying to get around there? Would we actually need the cars?
Yeah, it's a needful scenario. So in terms of a proactive approach, we do actually have leaflets that we couple up with our prevention activity around. I think the picture on front of the leaflet is 2 double parked cars and a fire engine not being able to get through. But we're in the business of saving lives, so if we do come up across something that we need to get through, then it's taking reasonable means to be able to ensure that we can get to that emergency to assist that member of the public.
We'll come back at a minute.
Yes.
health, I've kind of sit under occupational health, but health and safety and occupational health work really closely. Occupational health are represented on the health, safety and welfare committee, and also work through institutional the other meeting structures within the organisation. Members of my team undertake, you know, stress work related risk assessments and things like that. So there's a really close knit relationship between my team and myself and the occupational health team upstairs. So if anything that causes concern or may come across as significant, it's a mind up approach on how we deal with that. In terms of some of the stuff in place, we have really support of things in place for people with mental health through instant diffusion, through support, etc. So there's lots of mechanisms in place, and myself and occupational health work closely to be able to identify them.
Can I just say, answering your question, a few years ago when my sisters, they had to do move the bars, but I've got to point out, after they've done that and they've seen the situation, they knocked at the door and apologised for it, and I thought that was amazing. I thought, but they did actually have to move the bar and move it.
Any other can I just ask one thing? Obviously, you work with the other authorities and you're meeting with them on a regular basis. The question that I always ask, the figures that we have, are they comparable to the other authorities? Or are we doing better as we usually do?
So, in terms of collisions, ironically, I've just come out of the regional health and safety practitioner meeting this morning. So in terms of accident injury, yes, we benchmark the statistics are collated by government. They are published nationally. They were published in October. So what I tend to do, we'll be offered up a supplementary report to be able to show you where we are in terms of benchmarking for accident injury, because they've not been published for that reporting yet. I can confirm on the previous year we were performing absolutely excellent. I think there was one report earlier we were kind of middle of the table, but everything else we were right down or up, however you want to look at it, in terms of our performance. Really low figures for accident injury. In terms of collision, it's not collated. So I've mentioned it this morning in the practitioners meeting for the region, and sometimes it's difficult because of the variety. So fleet size, mileage, driving hours, turnouts, etc. Be able to kind of factor that into a something tangible, the way you do with the accident injury that's done population per thousand is really difficult, but it is something that I have raised and I am trying to get probably some sort of comparative for the road risk. But yeah, the accident injuries, that comparative would be out to.
Yeah, I appreciate that, because obviously part of our role in scrutiny is to try to, to compare ourselves with other authorities as well. So I appreciate that. Thank you for that. Okay, are there any further questions? Okay. Thanks, Chris. That's very helpful. Okay, so we now go on to agenda item 4.
Members make that
report. Oh, yeah, definitely. Okay, so we've got to agenda item 4, which is the People Plan Actions Update. Myself to introduce again, but I'm just going to go straight to the.
I'll do a very brief introduction, because it's very similar again to the other presentations, to be honest. But as members are aware, the People Plan was approved by the authority in June last year, and it captures our key people priorities. More importantly, it was developed in conjunction with our own staff. The People Plan 21-24, I say, replaces the former people strategy that we had, and the presentation will provide members with a view and an update of the initial work streams. And we have Mick Murnoch, who is our Director of People, who can represent it. I'm happy to take any questions.
I whistle stop tour through the people plan. As the deputy has already explained to you, the people plan came about because we decided to grow up our people strategy, if you want a better phrase. The real identity of it being that the organisation is run by three key plans: the integrated risk management plan, which looks at how we deliver things operational; financial plan, which is how we spend the money; and now the people plan, which is the management of our biggest resource, which is our people. So three key headline documents that you as members authorise the directors as an organisation moving forward. So this is just really to give you, first of all, an overview of the areas within the people plan. As the Dep has already mentioned, it's a lifespan of 21 to 24, so some of the things I'm just going to take you through are the work in progress at this minute in time. So the first element is that of leadership. Again, quite a big area, makes a fundamental difference to what we do, and the key piece of work, which again some of you will recall because you approved it, was that we have just gone through a whole method of rolling out our leadership message and our revised values. Now, that's just a quick reminder is what we look at. So these were put together by utilising the views of a number of focus groups from our staff around how they felt they operated in the organisation, how they felt what was best for them, and how they felt the organisation could move forward. So those were put together, and what we did do is we changed down from six values, which we've utilised for the last 15 years, to three, which are courage, integrity and compassion. They're the key drivers down a lot of what we do. So our leadership message encompasses that and begins to get all our workforce to be able to feel comfortable with how they particularly operate. So that could be back. Now for the last 7 months working with a company called Clarity, which has been delivering to all our staff a number of sessions around the leadership message and the values. So they've been day sessions where people can begin to look at how they operate within it, discuss how they work with each other, and what it also does is give people an insight into how they perform individually. So you may have come across a system that's broadly known as the colours, so it identifies individuals as four colours, which identifies how you particularly operate. So if you're green, you direct people related. If you're red, you make decisions at quite a pace. If you're blue, you're more considerate. If you're yellow, you have lots of ideas and need people to help you through those broad areas that they fall into. But fundamentally, those cause real interest in how people operate and how people feel that they interact and how they work moving forward. So along with that and the leadership message, been rolled out for the last 7 months and has been really seen as quite successful. The feedback from the staff has been really, really high, and what it does is set us in a position to move forward. As an organisational structure, our people obviously all working and have bring different skills and different areas to the workforce, but also have a particular way moving forward in conjunction with the authorities' leadership message. And now that's beginning to come together. So that further work will be built into the appraisal system, which will be adapted so that people will continue to have the conversations about themselves and how they align and their affinity to the organisation. So it's very much self-focused self-development. It will also build into our recruitment processes. So our recruitment processes will have a continuity around an assessment of individuals based on their organisational work and their organisational fit. So there's a bigger picture that will begin to come together over the next 12, 18 months, but that's fully embedded into the organisation. As well as leadership, another big element is looking at a set of accelerated development scheme. We'll touch on recruitment as I move forward in a minute, but our internal development is a real important issue to us and how we get forward there. We look at how we get our best people into the roles as quickly as possible. Culturally, there's been challenges around people stepping forward, coming forward and taking opportunities, and now we're beginning to pick that up at an earlier stage. So our conversations begin literally as people walk through the door. So from our training course and people beginning their training to be a firefighter, we're beginning to identify our future leaders. Our appraisal system, the way that's been revised, will do that also, and we begin to get a really big picture of the talent we have in the organisation. So running parallel to that, that people can either go through a gateway development mechanism of their own phase, or we'll identify potential future leaders, and that may well become this accelerated development, so that we can have some of our leaders into positions at a lot earlier stage to work with being good on accelerated development. The final area of the leadership way is continued development of our CMI courses. A lot of organisations have to buy in and pay for a lot of their leadership training. We, because the strength of the instructors we have in staff, we have to deliver ours internally. We have internal assessor set for status, which means we can deliver our own courses. So we're now devising some senior leadership courses at level 5 and level 7, and the opportunity to work potentially with police colleagues, NHS colleagues, and delivering some of that training. The second one is around cultures and values of our organisation. We've already talked around how those are embedded and crafted by our own staff, and now it's beginning how we put that in. Coaching and mentoring culture is where it's been worked. Some of you may know a lady called Lynn Hughes, who used to work in our team. She's continuing now to deliver our coaching and mentoring programme. The idea being that, as people grow and develop in this organisation, we don't give them loans, they seek to develop, so that people will be attached as they get into promotional situations with a coach. As people go into more senior roles, they'll be given a mentor. That would either be internally or externally. It's a whole process of ensuring that our staff grow with support, don't grow and are left alone in that journey, because sometimes, as many of us know, you find that sometimes you have the answers, sometimes you don't, and a lot of the time the hardest thing is to ask the question for support, is provide that support and to provide that mentoring process. So a large piece of work being done on coaching and mentoring. Another piece of work that we're looking at is to develop and build something called Just Culture. Those of you may have seen within the NHS, it's called the Merseyside system, but it's a useful tool. Over a number of years that I've been here, we've looked around sort of opening up discussions above and beyond those that take place through the trades, which we do on a formalised basis, allowing staff to speak early. A lot of the stuff around potential bullying harassment over the years has been that people just felt they had somewhere to go. There's other issues around when we look sometimes at our disciplines and our grievances and a number of other things that formalise very quickly because the conversations haven't taken place. So we're very keen to try and open up that debate, get inside those conversations and begin to look at a system whereby that people can have those open, transparent conversations early. And so you alleviate the need for formality in many situations. It's worked well for the NHS within Merseyside. Both myself and Mo Jovi have met and is helping with the qualities at the moment. We've met with their director, Amanda Oates. So we've had the first meetings. And what we've decided is rather than take the system, we're going to construct a Merseyside version of it. So for the next sort of 8-9 months, we're to begin on building that system. But what that will do is, I believe, will open up a very, very transparent communication process within this organisation. And will give us a lot of rich data, but also a lot of opportunity to deal with things early and informally, and take away a lot of formality of some of the things that we do. So we're going to begin on that. We're also looking at an award and recognition strategy. Current climates, current challenges for our staff in relation to a number of ways. Retention issues in many, many organisations are extremely challenging at this moment in time. And when salary increases is not always the option because of budgetary restrictions, we have to look at how we reward our staff in many, many different ways. So looking at the reward and recognition strategy has become a key piece of work, just to pick up and look at. The next part of the people strategy is to create a strong, inclusive organisation and a sense of belonging. Key element of that is to continue to work on the increase of diversity of our workforce through our positive action strategy. It served us fairly well in relation to our figures. We are performing quite well. The last HMI and the last national figures that threw out showed that in relation to female recruitment, we are one of only 4 out of 5 organisations who have 10% of female employees in operational side. And we are the only organisation in the country. It was actually matching see if she comes back. So in the meantime, what